Good morning, everyone. We are glad that you are here to worship with us this morning. Those of you in person and online, it's a great day to be in the house of the Lord. The ice is melted. We got some skid steers out here to clean the ice up yesterday, and they did a fantastic job. So our announcements for today, our ordination services for Clint Reed and myself will begin at 5:30 this afternoon. Ordination council for Clint will begin at 3:30, and my ordination council will begin at 4:30. All ordained men are invited to come and participate in the ordination council, and everyone is invited to come to the ordination service. So make plans to come out and support the both of us. Bible drills are back. If you have a child that's in fourth to sixth grade and want them to participate in Bible drills, get in contact with Miss Victoria Vaughan. She is spearheading that, heading that up. So if you want to do that, get in touch with her. And if you want your youth to be involved in youth Bible drill, get in touch with me or Miss Mary Wages. They will both have practice today at 1:30. Youth in the FLC and children in the children's building. So if you want to do that, get in touch with them. Journey Camp, the deadline to sign up for Journey Camp is this Wednesday, the 24th. Deposit $75. The dates are June 21st. Through the 25th. So if you want your child or your student to go, get that done as quick as you can. The spots are pretty much almost gone. Century Kid Camp will be at Linden Valley Conference Center in Linden, Tennessee, July 5th through the 9th. The deadline to sign up and get your deposits in is March 7th. For more information, you can contact me or Miss Leslie Randall. Our children's ministry project, speaking of Miss Leslie, I'm gonna get Miss Leslie to come talk about our children's ministry project, because she is the real deal.
Well, I don't know about that, but anyway, normally every year the WMU sponsors Children's Ministry Day, and it's around Valentine's Day. And with things being a little different this year, we decided, the Children's Committee decided to do it a little differently. So we're asking you to help us with the Children's Ministry Project. And the details are in the bulletin, but we contacted Ronald McDonald House, and they have around 30 children there staying. And Ainsley, of course, is one of our own that has received the benefit of Ronald McDonald House. So we're asking you to adopt a child as a family and put together a basket just to show encouragement for them. And there's a list of items that you can include in the bulletin, and there's a sign-up sheet in the back on the bulletin board, and the items are listed there as well. You can also include a note of encouragement to the child, and there is a place, if you're not here at church, you can do it online. On Facebook, you can comment and let us know that you would like to do one. But we need your help, because right now there's just two, maybe three baskets signed up for, so we need around 30. And if y'all can help us out with that, we would love it. And just a way to spread the love of Jesus to those children and their families. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Leslie. I will say again, she is the real deal, whether she believes it or not. So now I'm going to ask Miss Thea Taylor to come up. And while she's coming up, I'll remind you that we will enter into a quick time of business after service today to vote on our sanctuary renovation. So I hope you are excited about that. Miss Thea is going to talk about a potential missionary partnership with a collegiate missionary in the Northwest.
Good morning. I am going to tell you about another lady who is the real deal. And believe it or not, I wrote the real deal in my spiel here because she's the real deal. Today, I would like to bring to your attention a young lady who is one of our own here in Union County. She needs our support. Miss Sarah Reed is a missionary in Portland, Oregon. She grew up in Blue Springs and graduated from East Union in 2011, and she earned her degree from Blue Mountain College in 2015. She spent time in China as a short-term missionary after college, and then was a collegiate missionary in New Orleans while she worked on her seminary degree. Sarah actually has visited us here at Fredonia on a few occasions, sharing with our children about her experiences as a missionary in China. Here is a picture of Sarah with some of our girls a couple of years ago when she taught them about Christmas in China. The girls were quite smitten with Sarah's lesson. Sarah is now a campus missionary at Portland State University. She organizes campus outreach events and leads Bible studies and discipleship groups, among many other activities, to reach college students with the gospel of Jesus Christ. While she does have a small core group of Christian students there, most of her students that she meets know very little to nothing about true Christianity. Obviously, COVID has been a challenge to her ministry on a college campus, but she has seen positive results using virtual platforms. Here is a picture of a typical discipleship group from last year. This would be hard for me to participate in, really, but it works for this generation of college students. Sarah says that Portland is a very spiritually dark part of the country. Over 70% of the Portland population has no religious affiliation. You may remember the news reports of violent riots lasting more than 100 consecutive days in Portland. Sarah lives only a few miles from where the riots were and could hear the chaos from her home. God has protected her during these times. In 2021, Sarah will be following God's call to Vancouver, British Columbia. She will be involved in similar ministries with college students, specifically Chinese community there, as an associate of the International Mission Board. Once the Canadian borders are open, hopefully by this summer, she can transition to Canada. The reason that I'm bringing Sarah Reed before you today is to ask for your support. In past years, our church's contribution to the cooperative program would have funded missionaries such as Sarah. However, many people may not be aware that this is no longer true. A great number of Baptist missionaries are responsible for raising their own financial support from churches and individuals. Sarah is one of these missionaries who must raise her own financial support. My family has supported Sarah for the last 2 years financially and through prayer. I have personally watched Sarah look to be a good steward of what God provides through her ministry partners. She has brought in roommates to lower her expenses. She's moved to more economical housing, and she has taken on a part-time job at a local Baptist convention office. What moves me the most about Sarah, though, is the fact that she is a single lady on the mission field. She does not have the support of a husband, financial or otherwise. She is 2,500 miles away from her family, who is here in Union County. Now, I know full well that God will meet her needs and that Sarah is a faithful, spirit-filled, and courageous person. But I cannot help but look at my own daughter and wonder what it would be like to see her travel across country to share Christ with a dying world, all without the love and protection of a godly husband by her side. I would hope that churches back home would support my daughter, both financially and through prayer. I hope that you will prayerfully consider giving to the special offering for Sarah Reed. There's a little chest up here that you can bring your donations to. In a nutshell, I want you to know that Sarah Reed is the real deal. She's the real deal in her commitment to Christ and sharing the gospel with college students across the United States with little Christian influence. Your support will not be wasted. In fact, I believe that your support of Sarah's ministry will have a great eternal benefit to many. If you're interested in becoming a regular ministry partner for Sarah, please let me know and I can get you in touch with her. Thank you for your attention and may God bless you all.
Thank you, Ms. Thea. Prayerfully consider if you want to donate to Ms. Sarah Reed. Like she said, there is a chest for donations up here if you feel led to do that. So we are glad that you are here today to worship with us, those of you in person and online. So I'm going to pray and we'll get started for the day. Father, we come to you humbly and at your feet, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to enter into your throne room and into your presence. Lord, we We pray that you prepare our hearts for worship this morning through the singing of your praises and through Jeremy reading and preaching your word today, Lord. Thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for keeping us safe through the storms, Lord. Thank you for the beautiful sunshine outside that's melting all this ice, Lord. Thank you for a new day. Thank you for who you are and all that you've done for us, Lord. I pray that Jesus is glorified and exalted in our service today, and that if anyone needs to come to Christ today, that they accept the call that you've placed on their heart, and they accept you, Lord. We thank you for Jesus. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Well, it is definitely a joy to be in the Lord's house today, and I know I say it often, but what a blessing it is to be with you today. Just after the week that we've experienced, the things that we've seen throughout this week, to be here worshiping with you all. We are so blessed to hear praise reports from Miss Sylvia, to have Brother John here with us today, and what a precious blessing to have Sweet Ansley and the entire Thompson family here with us today. It is such a joy to know that the Lord is working in the lives of our people and to see His hand upon each and every one of us. And I pray that He continues to bless us, to keep His hand upon us, and to lead, guide, and direct us. This morning, if you would, let's all stand together as we rejoice in who the Lord is through the victory that we can find in Jesus Christ and in Him alone. Let's all sing together this morning, Victory in Jesus.
Blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me.
Singing this morning. 1 Corinthians 16:13 says, stand firm in the faith, be brave and strong.
Stand up, Lord Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss.
Would though continue to sing along with us, or feel free to sing along with us as we continue in our worship today. We're going to continue with a song that's called In Christ Alone, and you'll hear a part of The Solid Rock, because Jesus Christ is the rock with which we build our hope and our kingdom on. As we walk in the ways of the Lord, we seek His wisdom, His guidance, and we place our faith and our trust in Him. We cannot stand without Christ alone.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, his solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who
took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that
reading in my devotion this week, and one of the verses that went along with it is Matthew 5:13, and it says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men." And one of the parts of this devotion is so very powerful and strong that goes along with the song that we're about to sing right now, and it says, "The presence of Christ in you makes all that he is available to others. His salvation can free an addict. It can mend a broken home. It can heal the pain of the past, restore a wayward child, comfort a grieving heart. All of this is available to those around you as Christ expresses his life through you." And that's what we're here to do today. We are here to be the body of Christ, but not just inside of our doors today. It's when we reach outside, the people that we talk to, that we speak to, that we witness to. Let that be the body of Christ expressed.
It's crowded in you.
slips in, trying to fade into the faces, the girls teasing the laughter.
Throughout the weeks and months ahead. At this time, Mr. Johnny Thompson, would you lead us in a word of prayer?
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today just being so thankful that we're able to just be in your house today, God. God, we just thank you so much for what this church stands for and being a light on a hill, Father. We're just so thankful for that. But most of all, God, we're so thankful that you're our cornerstone. God, that we rest upon you and we trust you that you're going to take care of everything. And God, as we sang these songs, God, we thank you so much that the Spirit dwells among us. But God, as Brother Jeremy comes to break the bread of life, God, I pray that you anoint him from on high. God, give him the words to say that, God, that may draw us closer to you. God, for the one that does not know you out there, God, I just pray that they come to know you before it's everlasting too late. God, I just pray that you convict their hearts so that they just run to you. Father, I'm just so thankful for life and, God, everlasting life, God, that your Son bled, suffered, and died for me, for us. God, I'm thankful for that. God, I ask all this in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Johnny. Thank you. Praise team, thank you all for being here today. It is just good to see the house of the Lord be filled with its people. I'm excited about opening up God's Word. I want to invite you to do that now as we're going to turn to Philippians chapter 1. We're going through this letter or book. We're come to the conclusion of chapter 1, that is, looking in verses 27 through 30 today. You know, I don't think it's too hard to believe that right now as Americans, Christians are being targeted, they're being mocked and ostracized for their faith and beliefs, perhaps more than they ever have before. I mean, let's just face it, this country, right, was founded upon Christian morals, Christian beliefs, but now as we live in the 21st century today, those very same values and beliefs are seen by many, at least, as being outdated, as being old-fashioned, as being closed-minded. Furthermore, I think it's also safe to say that even if we just went back, even just 20 years ago, I would say a large chunk of America could be found in pews like this, sitting in a pew and being a part of a body of Christ, as we just sang. But now, let's just face it, as we come to church, as we drive by our neighborhoods and different homes, we see many people either asleep or lying in bed or watching TV on the couch because what was once valued and seen as being important no longer is. In fact, in my studies this week, I came across an article, and it was just very eye-opening to me. Basically, the article was a survey that a group of people did. They surveyed some portion of the population of the United States. I'm not sure where. But the survey was this. They asked American citizens which minority group they would not want to be neighbors with. And here's what this study showed. They said that 1% said that they would not want to have Catholics as neighbors. 2% said that they would not want to have a Protestant living next door. 3% said that Jews, they wouldn't want to have Jews living beside them. 9% said that they wouldn't want to have Hispanics living across the fence from them. 11% said they wouldn't want to have gang members living right next to them. And then finally, get this, 13 of the people who were surveyed in this study said that they would not want to live next door to a religious fundamentalist. Church, I don't know about you, but I about spilt my cup of coffee when I said, are you kidding me? You would rather have a gang member than a religious fundamentalist. Listen, if that's true, I don't know if that study is true, but if that is true, and I believe to a large portion of what it's been said here is true, then we need to realize, right, that today we are living in a world, we are living in a country where more and more American citizens are becoming hostile towards the Christian faith, and especially towards Christians who are bold in their faith and are willing to make a stand for what they believe. Because you see, bold believers, right? Bold believers, I'm talking about the type that doesn't just fold in with the culture and the societal norms of today. Those are the people that are being labeled as being narrow, as myopic, as bigoted and biased. Yet, being a bold believer is exactly what God calls each one of us to be. His word tells us to not conform to the fleshly desires of this world. And so that puts us in a bit of a dilemma, doesn't it? Because certainly there's a part of us that doesn't want to be a part of this group of people that's being targeted, that's being mocked, that's being unrightfully labeled as being closed-minded and prejudiced just because we claim to be Christian. Yet at the same time, we also know that God calls us to stand up for our beliefs, to not cut corners with our theology and way of thinking according to the Bible in an attempt to blend in. But if we do that, well, that very well may mean that we're going to stick out and that we will be ridiculed for our faith. So what should our response be? Listen, no one understood this dilemma better than Paul did. He understood that if you become a Christian and you truly sought to follow Christ boldly, then your life wouldn't become a playground. No, it will become a battleground. He understood that if you make a stand for Christ, then you will face opposition. In fact, in one of his letters, 2 Corinthians 11, he kind of lists out his resume as he's dealt with this firsthand. He tells us, because of his faith, because of his bold witness, that he received 40 lashes from the Jews. 3 times he was beaten with a rod. 1 time he was even stoned, and that's not Colorado stoned. That's stoned with rocks. See, as we come to our text this morning, what we're going to find is a shift taking place in Paul's letter to the Philippian believers, because what Paul has been doing up to this point is he's been talking about his imprisonment. Now, though, he's going to shift his focus to the Philippians' predicament. Instead, in the Philippians' predicament is that while they are a growing group of believers, while they are a growing group of a church that's come together and is formed there, they at the same time are faced with the challenges and the pressures associated with an unbelieving world that surrounds them. And so what Paul is doing right here is he begins to challenge and encourage the Philippian believers to remain steadfast in their faith and to continue being bold even in the midst of fears and hostilities and the pressures that they are surrounded with. And so with all that in mind, let's just read our text for today. Let's see how Paul comforts and challenges the Philippian believers, the people he's writing to, beginning in verse 27. Paul says, "Just one thing, as citizens of heaven, live your life worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or am absent, I will hear about you that you are standing firm in one spirit, in one accord, contending together for the faith of the gospel, not being frightened in any way by your opponents. And this is a sign of destruction for them, but of your salvation, and this is from God. For it has been granted to you on Christ's behalf not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are engaged in the same struggle that you saw I had and now hear that I have." Now, before we start digging in to this verse or these verses, I want you to do something for me. This is the youth pastor side of me that I still have, so play along. I want you to close your eyes for a moment, and I'm serious. I actually want you to close your eyes. Okay, don't go to sleep on me, but you're going to need to open them up soon. But close your eyes for now. And now I want you to picture yourself standing. You can be standing anywhere, it doesn't matter, but you're standing. And as you're standing, a hostile group or a hostile crowd, they begin to surround you on all sides. And this crowd is yelling at you. Now, this crowd is mocking you and ridiculing you. This crowd wants nothing more than to see you succumb to their jeers and their insults and fall down in defeat. All right, you got that picture in your mind? Okay, good. Go ahead and open them back up, because the reality is this. Okay, while that picture is a fictional image that I just tried to make you place in your own mind, in all actuality, that image represents our lives as Christians today, as we are increasingly living in a hostile environment, living in a country where many want to see the Christian faith just fade away. And so the big question for us today is this, the question that I hope that we can try to seek some answer in. The question is this: how do you stand tall when the world wants to see you fall? How do you do that? How do you stand tall when the world wants to see you fall? In other words, how do you stand tall for your faith when it seems like the world just wants to knock you down, to push you aside because your beliefs, your convictions do not line up with their beliefs and their convictions and their agenda? Well, according to Paul here, There are four qualities that we are to have in order to stand up, to keep being bold in our gospel faith, even in the midst of hostility. And they are, if you're taking notes, write these down. Number one, consistency. And number two, unity. Number three, bravery. And number four, agony. Consistency, unity, bravery, and agony. These four qualities Paul is going to show us here. They're going to support us. They're going to give us a foundation that we need to be able to stand tall when the world just wants to seem to push us down and fall. And so with that in mind, let's just talk about these qualities this morning that Paul lists out here. And again, we'll start with the first one first, and that is consistency. Consistency. This is the first quality that Paul is showing us that we are to have. Look again at what he says in the beginning of verse 27. Paul says, "Just one thing, as citizens of heaven, live your life worthy of the gospel of Christ." Now, to help us just understand and appreciate this section of verse 27, I actually want to just break it down into two main parts, okay? So let's break this in half. First, I want to draw your attention to what Paul says at the beginning of this verse when he says, as citizens of heaven. Because you see, what Paul is doing here is he is reminding the Philippian believers that while they are citizens of Philippi, while they are ultimately under Roman authority as believers, their true citizenship lies in heaven. And they are under the authority of God Himself. And listen, I point that out to you because as I mentioned at the very beginning of this sermon series, when we were doing an introductory walkthrough of the book of Philippians, I reminded you that the city of Philippi was in many ways, according to scholars, like a miniature version of Rome. In other words, if you are familiar with the sights and sounds of Rome, then if you were to walk the streets of Philippi, then you would have said, this kind of reminds me of Rome. And you see, that was seen as a compliment in those days, for Rome was considered to be a grandiose powerhouse. And so, in saying things like that, the citizens of Philippi begin to kind of stick out their chest and say, look at our great place. Look at our great city. They took great pride in where they lived. They would have done everything possible in their power to be honorable citizens, to be hardworking citizens, to keep up this image and this reputation that they had because they deeply cared about upholding it amongst the world. But you see, what Paul is doing here is he's trying to fix the Philippians' eyes not on their earthly citizenship, but on their heavenly citizenship instead. In fact, later on in Philippians, we'll get there one day, in Philippians 3, verse 20, Paul says these words. He says, we, the Philippians, that being the people of God, are citizens of heaven. And so Paul's point here isn't that we should neglect our responsibilities and all the things that we need to do here on earth in places like Philippi or places for us like New Albany, but that as citizens of heaven, how much more so should we represent God's kingdom and how we live and how we act and how we serve? And so that's what Paul's getting at in verse 27 when he says, as citizens of heaven, live your life worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because while we should live our life worthy of being a good and honorable citizen as believers, we are even more so responsible to live a life worthy of the gospel that points others to Christ, that helps build up our ultimate and final residence, which is not here, but in heaven. Now, before we move on, let me just point out something else to you right here in this section of verse 27, and that's the word worthy. If you're one to take notes or underline things in your Bible, I would actually encourage you to underline that word worthy. Do you see where it says that in verse 27? Paul says, live your life worthy of the gospel of Christ Jesus. See, that word worthy in the Greek is the word axios. And it means to balance the scales or to weigh as much as something else does. Kind of like those old-timey scales. You see those in the movies where there's like these two buckets. Yeah, I got a picture for you because I'm just a visual learner. I don't know if you're like that too. But you understand that's kind of the idea here. right? And so what Paul's point is that as believers, your conduct, that being the way you live, the way you act, the way you speak, the way you serve, it should carry as much weight or be worthy of that of the gospel. And so just to go back to that scale analogy for a moment, can you put that picture back up on there real quick? Now imagine that one side of that scale, it represents what you say you believe in as a Christian. Okay, that's one bucket, what you say you believe in as a Christian. And then the other side of that scale, or the other bucket for the image that we have up here, it represents how you actually live your life as a believer. You got that? Well, Paul's point here is that your life should match up or be of equal weight to the gospel. Or said another way, our practice, that being how we live our lives, should match up or be of equal value or weight to our proclamation. That, of course, being what we say we believe in, which is the gospel. So what Paul is doing here is he's calling us to live a consistent Christian life. He's saying, if you call yourself to be a Christian, then live up to your name. Live a life worthy of the gospel, for a Christian must never live beneath his theology or belief, and I'll tell you why. Because one of the greatest weapons, listen to this, one of the greatest weapons you can use against the forces of evil is a consistent, godly life. One of the greatest weapons, one of the greatest tools is a consistent, godly life. For example, when you are tempted by the devil, when you are surrounded by the pressures of an unbelieving world, you're going to do one of two things. Option A, you're going to succumb to those sinful temptations, whatever they are. That's if you live a life of compromise, of inconsistency in your Christian faith and values and beliefs. Or option B, you're going to stand up because you're living a consistent, godly life that's worthy of the gospel. And listen, I understand for many of you here today, many of you want to choose that second option. And so oftentimes you find yourself still falling prey to sin. Listen, I get that. I really do. I'm in the same boat. But the beauty of the gospel is that we serve a God who gives us grace, who gives us forgiveness in those moments of weakness, yet at the same time as citizens of heaven, to be able to get back up on our feet, to be able to continue to pursue this godly, consistent life that He has called us to. And so may I just ask you this morning, are you living a life that is filled with love? Because that's what the gospel is. Is your life filled with holiness? Because the gospel is. Is your life filled with Christian character and integrity and consistency? Because the gospel is. Live your life worthy of the gospel, of equal value or weight to it. May your practice match up with your proclamation. So consistency, that's the first tool, weapon, strength that will help us to stand tall when the world wants to see us fall. But Paul's going to give us another quality here to help build upon this foundation that he's showing us, and that is number two, we are to have unity. Unity. Look again at what Paul says here as he continues on in verse 27. He says, "Then, whether I come and see you or am absent, I will hear about you that you are standing firm in one spirit, in one accord, contending together for the faith of the gospel." Now, if you remember two Sundays ago, we didn't have church this past Sunday, but two Sundays ago, we kind of talked about this. We talked about how Paul didn't know whether or not he was going to live or die. I mean, that's basically what this previous section of Scripture said, right? He says, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get out of this prison cell that I'm in, or I may just end up staying in here and I may die. I don't know. And so that's what he's saying in verse 27, that he doesn't know whether or not he's going to be able to travel back to the city of Philippi to see his beloved people, the Philippians, because he really had no idea. But regardless, that's not the point that Paul is trying to make here in this verse. No, Paul's point here is that whether he comes to see them or not, he wants to hear reports of how they are standing firm in the midst of opposition. Now, church, let me just say that that's soldier talk right there. In fact, the word standing firm that Paul uses here, it's a military term that describes a soldier who would dig in, who would stand his or her ground even in the midst of tremendous opposition. And so to go back to that image that I try to have you place in your mind, picture yourself there again. I want you to now picture yourself standing upright, but when that hostile crowd surrounds you, I want you to imagine yourself to widen your stance, right? To dig your heels in, to be ready to stand firm in the midst of hostility, because that is the idea, the picture that Paul paints, which is to stand firm against our enemy. But I want you to notice something else in this verse. Because notice that Paul is not just saying that we are to do this individually, but he's calling us to stand our ground together. See, this is where the unity comes into play. For example, just look at the wording again at what Paul uses here in verse 27. He says, just one thing, as citizens of heaven, live your life worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or am absent, I will hear about you that you are standing firm in one spirit, in one accord, contending together for the faith of the gospel. And so the idea here is, yes, you need to widen your stance. You need to dig your heels in the mud or the sand when spiritual opposition comes your way. But how much more would you be effective if you weren't just doing that, but that your brother and sister in Christ had locked hands with you and there was someone on this side of you, and there was someone on this side of you, and there was someone on this side of you, and so on and so on. See, your chance of spiritual victory when these times of troubles and temptation comes greatly increases when you surround yourself with other like-minded believers. They're going to help you. They're going to support you and fend off attacks from the enemy far better than you ever could by yourself. And in fact, just go ahead and jot this down. This is kind of a cheesy saying, but I think it's good. And that's this: God's people are better when they're together. I mean, God's people are better when they are together. I know that's a little cheesy and cliche, but that's so true, because you see, when we are unified as a body of believers, we are strong, and when we are strong, we can help others stand tall when others want to see us fall. Now, before I move on, I want to point one more thing out here to you, and that's about this word unity. You see, unity, listen to this, there's a lot of confusion surrounding with unity. Unity does not necessarily mean unanimity, where everybody thinks the same. And at the same time, unity doesn't necessarily mean uniformity, where everybody always acts the same. For example, as much as I love you guys, if I just open up the floor and I just said, hey, what do you think the ideal service should look like? Well, like, what are the elements of that? And then if I were to ask, and what do you think Sunday school should look like? Could you just give me your thoughts there? Or what do you think that color wall should be? Or what color carpet should this be? You see, if I open up the floor to that, I get a lot of different answers. Much as I love you guys, I'm going to guess that I'd walk away being a little disheartened, because, I mean, this person would have that opinion, this person would have that opinion, and so on and so on. In fact, I've heard it said before that if two people agree on everything, then one of them is not listening. Okay, and I got to say, I agree with that, because even with two people, you're going to have differences of opinion. So how much more so in a church like this one will we have differences of opinion when it comes to things like this? But you see, just because we have a difference of opinion and things like that, that does not necessarily mean that we are not unified. Because when it comes to the non-essentials of the faith, those things that I mentioned earlier, listen, we have the ability and the freedom to be able to express ourselves. And I believe that's part of God's design. He's made us different. We're very diverse as the body of Christ in this church, and I think that's good. However, when it comes to the core essentials of the faith, those things being like the inerrancy of God's Word, the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ being the Son of God, Jesus Christ dying on the cross for our sins, well, then we need to be like-minded. We need to be unified in that. That represents the DNA, the core values of who we are as a body of believers. In other words, unity doesn't necessarily mean unanimity or uniformity. Unity does mean harmony. Unity means harmony. It means working together. Though we may have a difference of opinion there, we come together over the core essentials of the faith. We choose to cooperate with each other. And so, church, can I just challenge you as a body of believers who is very diverse? We are a multi-generational church, and I think that's great. Praise God. But may we come together. May we come together and have unity, have harmony with one another. More importantly, may we stand together when hostility or opposition may come our way. All right, so if we want to stand tall and when the world wants to see us fall, then number one, we need to be consistent in our faith. We need to live a life worthy of the gospel. Number two, we need to be unified in our faith. We need to stand our ground, not just by ourselves, but with other like-minded believers. That is the church. And then related to that, Paul gives us a third quality that we are to have here, and that is number three, we are to have bravery. Bravery. Look at Paul's teaching here as he continues on in verse 28. Paul says, "Not being frightened in any way by your opponents, this is a sign of destruction for them, but of your salvation, and this is from God." Now, I love what Paul is doing here because you see that the Philippian believers in Philippi, they were under Roman rule. They were under Roman authority. And so they begin to realize that what happened to Paul very well could happen to them. Just because it happened over there with Paul does not mean that it could not also happen to where they were living in as well. And so it's almost like Paul sits as their fears here and is a pastor and he tells them, listen, do not be frightened in any way by your opponents, meaning that we shouldn't be afraid of unbelievers who are hostile towards us and the Christian faith. Now listen, that's admirable. I mean, it really is. I would say that's even brave. To stand up and to face our enemy like that, knowing good and well that they could throw you in jail just like they did for Paul. They could kill you as they commonly did. But even so, why do something like that? I mean, why not try to live in the shadows if you were a Philippian believer? Why not try to blend in? Why not, instead of trying to be brave, seek to be a conformist? Do whatever the Romans tell you. Be on their good side. Just do whatever they ask you to do. After all, wouldn't that increase your safety? Well, certainly, I'm sure it would have, and I'm sure that was a temptation for those believers. But see, what I love about what Paul does here at the end of this verse is that he tells the Philippian believers why they should be brave, even when it was dangerous to do so. And his reasoning is this. It proves that they are a believer. That's the why. In other words, when opposition comes your way for the sake of Christ, it's a sign from God. And if you don't believe me, then look at what Paul says at the end of verse 28, because that's basically what he's saying. Look again, he says, not being frightened in any way by your opponents, this is a sign of destruction for them, but a sign of your salvation. And this is from God. So to put it all together for you, let me just sum it up by saying this. When you are bold, when you are brave and you stand up for your faith in the midst of opposition, it shows you and the rest of the world that you are who you say you are. And at the same time, it shows you that you belong to the kingdom of God, while these other people who are hostile towards you belong to the kingdom of darkness and will ultimately, if they do not repent of their sins, will be cast into the gates of hell itself. And so Paul's point here is that as a Christian, you should be brave in your faith. You should see conflict and opposition not as a roadblock, not as a hindrance, but almost as like a badge of honor. Because when you are hassled for the sake of Christ, you can know that you're on the winning side of the battle between dark and light, and that one day you will be rewarded for that bravery in heaven. And so if that's been your experience lately, let me just encourage you by challenging you to be a brave nonconformist. We need to be a brave nonconformist, not by looking for a fight, but that when the fight comes to us, we'll stand our ground. We'll not give in to those pressures. We'll stay true to our Christian faith and beliefs, because when we do, we will shine like a bright diamond against the backdrop of the world. And that, my friend, that's not only going to please God, but that's going to exalt Christ. And through your bravery, you will make a difference and encourage other believers to do the same as well. You know, one of the things that I love about the Scriptures is that this theme, and I've talked about this earlier, but that this theme of Christian bravery, it's found all throughout Philippians. I think we're seeing that, but it's really found all throughout God's Word. For example, when the Roman mob, when they came to arrest Jesus in the garden, you remember that scene? When they came to arrest him, notice the Scriptures say that Jesus did not try to run away in that situation. I mean, Jesus would have had the power to just make them stop, right? What did Jesus do? What did Jesus do? He stood tall. When they asked who Jesus was, Jesus says, it is me. He was not afraid. He stood tall. He was not ashamed of who he was. Or how about Stephen? Remember Stephen? When he was surrounded by a hostile group of believers who wanted to kill him, who ultimately did kill him, did he cower in fear in that moment? Did he try to renounce his faith so that he could live? He couldn't shut his mouth. Even when they were throwing rocks at him, he kept talking about how he could see heaven. He was not ashamed of who he was as a believer. And then there's Peter. I mean, if anyone was skittish of their faith, it was Peter, right? I mean, Peter, he denied Christ not only once, not only twice, but three times. The Bible also tells us that he was filled with the Holy Spirit. That on the day of Pentecost, when he preached, thousands received the gospel in their life. He was emboldened. He stood tall. Church, that's bravery. That's courage. Paul tells us here in verse 28 that when we exemplify that in our lives, it is proof that we are saved. So don't be afraid to go outside these four walls and be bold for Christ. For if you bow before God, you can stand before anyone. Did you catch that? If you bow before the holy God, you can stand before anyone. The Scriptures tells us in Romans that if God is for us, who can be against us? And even if we find ourselves in situations, we can know, trust, and believe that God will be with us in those moments. He will allow us and embolden us to stand firm in our faith. And again, one day we will be rewarded for that in heaven itself. All right, so again, if we want to stand tall when the world wants to see us fall, number one, we must have consistency. Number two, unity. Number three, bravery. Paul is going to close out this section of his letter, chapter one, by giving us one more quality that we're going to look at today, and that is agony. We are to have agony. Look with me one last time as Paul wraps up his teachings, beginning in verse 29 in chapter 1. Paul says, "For it has been granted to you on Christ's behalf not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are engaged in the same struggle that you saw I had and now hear that I have." Now I must say, it almost seems like Paul doesn't want to close out this chapter on a high note, does he? I mean, wouldn't it be nice for Paul to just sort of wrap up his section of his letter here in chapter 1 and basically say something along the lines of, you know, if you live your life worthy of the gospel, if you're unified, if you're brave, then nothing bad's going to happen to you. I mean, that sounds pretty good, right? There's honestly a lot of preachers that would preach that, but here's the problem. That's not the reality of the Christian. And Paul knew that firsthand. So there's a lot of people, maybe even people in this church, I would say especially young believers, who think that when you make a decision to follow Christ, that all your problems, all your struggles, all those things that you deal with and struggle with, they're just magically going to melt away. You know, in one sense, I guess they're right, because through believing in Christ, the biggest battle has been won. And you should feel very freeing and liberating in that, because it certainly is. But you see, while it's true that our biggest battle in life has been won when we made a decision to follow Christ, the reality is that your decision to follow Christ has now invited a whole host of new problems. The enemy has put a bullseye right on your chest, and he wants nothing more than to take you down. Now listen, I think any mature believer who's walked with the Lord for more than just a couple of days would nod their head in agreement that that is certainly true. But listen, if you're skeptical of this, don't take my word for it. Don't take their word for it. Take Jesus' word for it, because he himself says, in this world you will have tribulation, and if the world hated me, then don't be surprised when it hates you. That's the idea that Paul has here. Again, he understands this firsthand, that if you believe in Christ, then you will suffer for Christ, because that's just the reality of the world that we are living in today. There are people that want to see us fall from the faith. There are people that are going to mock and ridicule us and see us as being narrow-minded, because that's just the world we live in. Listen, I want to point something else out to you here. Because see, in verse 29, Paul writes something really interesting. I want to highlight it to you. Notice the language he uses in this verse. He says, for it has been, what's that word say? Granted. It has been granted to you on Christ's behalf, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him. In other words, what Paul is saying here is that through Christ, you have been granted, you have been given the privilege of salvation, of eternal life. Praise God, hallelujah. But then he also says, but you've been given or been granted the privilege of suffering. And what Paul is saying here is that you should praise God for that too. And listen, I know some of you are saying, Jeremy, listen, I will praise God for salvation. I mean, thank you, Lord, but this whole suffering part, I could live without that. Listen, I understand where you're coming from in saying things like that, but Paul's point here is that if you suffer for Christ well, and you suffer for him for the right reasons, then you should see that as a privilege. And really for a couple of different reasons. Paul talked about these already throughout this letter. Number one, when you suffer for Christ, it's going to refine your faith. It's going to strengthen your faith. Number two, when you suffer for Christ, it's going to produce patience and perseverance in your faith when future trials and troubles come your way. Number three, when you suffer for Christ, it will inspire and embolden other believers to go out and do the same thing, as we've seen Paul mention this in verse 14. And then number four, when you suffer for Christ, it will bring God glory and honor. And again, you're going to be rewarded for that in heaven, as we've learned about in our text today. And so church, as we close this morning, I want you to understand that it is these four qualities that Paul gives us here that we need to have if we are going to stand firm, if we are going to hold our ground, if we are going to stand tall when the world wants to see us fall. We must be consistent in our walk, in our life. We must be unified in our faith amongst other believers, the body of Christ. We must be brave in the midst of hostility against our enemies, and we must be willing to suffer for Christ. Church, when we do that, we will be like a strong pillar that will refuse to fall down from the weight and the pressures of this unbelieving world. will be like a fortified wall that refuses to be breached from the enemies of the faith, and we'll be like a firm foundation that will refuse to crack, that will refuse to break, though the wind and the waves can oftentimes be fierce. Church, let's be a people like that. Let's be a body of believers that will trust in Christ, that will stand our ground, that is willing to suffer even if it comes to it. For when we do that, we know we are advancing the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word today. God, the admonitions and the teachings that are given to us here, God, Father, they're so challenging, and God, oftentimes they're just so difficult. God, it seems as if each and every day we are living in a country, let alone a world, that seems to just be growing hostile towards the Christian faith, that seems to be looking for any insult it can give towards us. And so, Father, I pray that we would not succumb to those things, that we would not succumb to these temptations of bending our theology to fit in with the societal norms. I pray that we would not cut corners in our beliefs so that we could blend in with the rest of the world. God, I pray that we would stay true to your word. God, that we would dig in, that we would stand tall even when the world wants to sometimes seem like it wants to see us fall. God, that requires a few different things according to your word. It requires consistency in our walk, not living a life of compromise, but living a life worthy of the gospel. It requires unity, which means we cannot do this on our own. This idea of I'm just going to have my own personalized religion and I'm just going to have a relationship with Christ with no other believers and have no other community, God, that is a recipe for disaster. God, you've given us a church, this church, so that we can lock hands and arms with our brothers and sisters in Christ, so that we can surround our own lives, our families, God, so that we can be fortified against these pressures that come in this world. God, we must be brave. God, we must be brave when these moments in our lives come. Father, maybe for some of us it's come now. Maybe it's coming down the road. I don't know, but we must be brave and we must be willing to suffer. God, we must be willing to suffer. That's not something that we necessarily think about often, but God, it is something that you call us to be a servant for you, to be a slave for you, to suffer for you. Father, that's proof of our salvation. That's proof that we are on the winning side of light and dark. And so, Father, I pray that we would embody these four things. And Father, if there's someone here that has not, God, I pray that they would come, seek forgiveness, repentance. They would ask for one of or more of these qualities, or maybe there's someone here today and, God, they don't even know you. God, I know you can do a great work in their life. I know that you'll accept them with open hands and open arms. And God, you'll give them these things along the way. God, however you want to use us, however you want to speak to us, however you want us to change any direction or area in our lives, God, I pray that we would do so in these next few moments. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand? I know I've given you several illustrations for this teaching. I'll give you one more. Maybe it'll be helpful for some of you. I don't know, but one more illustration is this. These four values, character traits that Paul gives us here, they're kind of like the four legs of a chair. You see these chairs behind me. Now, if I was to take off one of those legs, could that chair stand up? Could it stand up? I mean, especially if I wanted to sit down and put some pressure on, would it be able to stand? Took off two, even more so. Three, even more so. You see, we got to have all four of these things. We We've got to have consistency, unity, bravery, and agony in our lives if we are going to stand firm. And so may I ask you right now as we begin to close, are you consistent in your faith, in your walk? I'm not talking about right now. I'm talking about behind closed doors. I'm talking about on the weekends. I'm talking about when you're wanting to blend in and be popular with your friends or whatever the case may be. Are you being consistent in those moments? Or are you being unified with other believers? Listen, I know COVID's kind of thrown us all for a loop, but I believe that God wants us to come together. And that's not just here. That's certainly a part of that, but He wants us to come together in our Sunday school classrooms. He wants us to come together in doing service projects for this community, going on mission trips. He wants us to have unity, harmony with each other. Do you have that? Can you say, I embody that? Or are you being brave? At the workplace, when someone makes some crude joke, maybe mocks or ridicules, something that would go against your Christian values, what do? Do you laugh? Do you just not say anything, or do you stand up? We need to be brave. And lastly, we need to be willing to suffer. Are you willing to suffer? That's a mark of a Christian. It's proof that you are saved. We have to have these four things. If you don't have one of those, you can come down right now. You can ask God to give you those things. I'd love to pray for you about those things. Again, maybe there's others of you who are here today. You realize you don't have any of those. So that is okay. That's a great starting point for the gospel to infiltrate your life, for you to start this journey. God's going to give you those things. This is a church family that we can come together and encourage and teach those things along the way. However God wants you to respond, I pray that you would do so right now.
Glorified in your church.
ahead and be seated. We are excited about a few different decisions that have been made today, and I'll ask Jacob to stand up first. For those of you who don't know, Jacob, you come right here, bud. For those of you who don't know, Jacob Aaron has been involved in our student ministry for quite some time. I know he started coming when I was the student pastor here, and certainly since Hunter has come, he's continued to be very involved. He's probably have seen him on many occasions here on Sunday mornings. He's been coming here consistently. And listen, Jacob has decided to make just one of the greatest, actually the greatest, decision that you can make, and that is that Jacob has accepted Christ into his heart, and he has been saved. Amen is correct, and he wants to be baptized as well. So can we just give a round of applause for that? We are excited. Me and Hunter were able to meet with Jacob. Actually, last week, I know we some of us were here early, and then we decided we needed to leave because of the ice storm coming in. But before those moments took place, me and Hunter were able to meet with Jacob, and just to hear his heart, to hear how God has moved in his life, and he's made this decision to, again, ask Jesus to come into his heart, and he wants to seek membership of this church. He wants to be baptized in this church, and so we hope to make arrangements for that in the near future. Listen, I think we've already established this by the round of applause, but if you confirm these things, approve of these things, can you just give another round of applause? Amen. I think that's unanimous, Jacob. Absolutely. Well, listen, we got another decision that's been made. I'm going to ask the Robbins family if they would come up. I know many of you know the Robbins family. I know they just know a lot of people. I've kind of caught on that. Seems like every time I go out to eat with them, they're like, hey, hey. So I know many of you are very familiar with who they are, but we have just been thrilled that they have been coming to our church for quite some time. They've been looking for a new church home. They're moving to the Ingemar area, and so they're making plans to do that, and they've been wanting to find a church that was in this community, and they wanted to be involved in a church that was planted here in this community. And so they are coming. By statement or by letter from First Baptist New Albany. And so, again, this is Brad and Ashley and their two kids, Walker and Mitchell. And so if you approve of them transferring their letter to be a part of this church, would you give a round of applause? Listen, we are thrilled about these two decisions. Listen, we actually have to go into a time of business. And so after our time of business, I would encourage you in a very safe way, that is, due to COVID, to just welcome them as a part of our family, to congratulate them on their decisions and just to make them feel loved and feel like they belong here, because they certainly do. Listen, I'm going to ask you guys to go ahead and just, you can sit back down on that front pew or go back to where you were. It does not matter to me. But we do need to enter into a time of business. So listen, I'm just going to pray, and that'll sort of close out our service. And then from there, we'll enter into a time of business. And if you're a guest with us today, you're welcome to stay here for this. It is a vote that's only going to be for our members. But if you'd like to stay, you're welcome to do that. If you'd like to leave after I pray, then I'll give you a time to slip out real quick. But let me pray as we close out this service. Father, again, we're just so thankful for today, God. We're thankful for, God, being a part of, God, your kingdom, your house, as this church is a part of that. God, I'm thankful for the service that we've been able to have today, for the Sunday school hour that we were able to be a part of today. God, I pray that we can walk out of here, God, just being encouraged, being inspired by your word. God, living a life that is bold, living a life that would stand tall against any opposition that would come our way. In Jesus' name, amen.